I have weird hobbies. And
weird hobbies.
I have weird hobbies. So things I like, I do espalier apple trees. Yep. So you grow an apple tree up and you train it along wires. Mm-hmm. And I watch a lot of videos about English history. So I decided, hey, it'd be funny to have this prompt, which was a robot wearing Wellington boots pruning a espalier apple tree in front of an English manor house.
I mean, you're just really trying to challenge this thing, right?
Trying to challenge it. And I had been to Phipps Conservatory in Pittsburgh and they have a Monet exhibit.
Right.
So it's like, okay, all of that, but in the style of Monet, figuring that can't possibly appear in any AI training data set because it's insane.
Mm-hmm.
And what popped out is actually, I think, actually a pretty cool image that I liked so much that I got printed on a piece of metal and hung on my wall.
I mean, like, you're a true roboticist, right? What a roboticist does, immediately go and try and figure out how to confuse
how to
the
break
thing,
something.
How to break it, right?
Right. And not only did it not break, it got it right on the first try,
mm-hmm.
Which is weird.
Yeah, really kind of uncanny almost. Like, hard to believe that it did that well.
Right. So I think for those of us who've been around for a while and seen AI from this classifier, like, what is the world? Mm-hmm. Oh, there's a person standing here, there's a dog, there's a fire hydrant,
right,
a car. But there's really been two cases that have surprised me in the last 20 years. One of them was Dall-E, seeing it do something that actually appears relatively novel. And the second was something that came out of your lab at the time at OSU and now here with the Cassie robot using a learned policy, which is actually hard to do. It's harder than the image classification stuff.
Very different.
Doing stairs, and in particular doing behaviors that look very novel and emergent that it was not necessarily directly trained to do.
Honestly, the key to getting Cassie to walk and run a 5K and go up and down stairs and all those things using a learned policy is really understanding the physics of what you're trying to achieve in the first place. You kind of have to already know the answer. And then, you know, the learning policies are a way to represent that, to really find the nuances and the details and get a really good answer. So is AI just what everybody should do for everything? Does that solve all problems?
I think what it doesn't necessarily solve, and I think there's reasonable evidence, I know we've talked about this in the context of biology over the years.
Mm-hmm.
If learning were the solution to all biological movement, then all biological movement would be learned, and it's demonstrably not. So baby horses, for instance, can walk shortly after birth. There's obviously, from first principles neurobiology, not enough time for them to learn how to do it. So there must be a physical, biological, or structural component to the motion that's not learned. But I think, you know, the broader question is there a abstract ability to apply AI to any mechanical system to cause it to do whatever you want? And the answer is
definitely not.
Definitely not.
Mm-hmm.
And in the case of Cassie, I think where your lab team, you know, before it was the agility team, really saw a lot of utility was actually in stretching the existing understanding of the controls to make it do more as opposed to causing the initial behavior to exist to begin with.
Well, right. So when we first started exploring using learning on the robot, the starting point was a working robot that was demonstrated to be able to walk and run, and much more traditional control approaches to successfully walk and run. That was the seed. Now, I will say that ultimately the behaviors that resulted in, you know, the stair climbing or the 5K didn't use that controller as a seed. They used much more, we were very careful in structuring the problem for the system to learn.
And to get back to the point of stretching the existing mechanical capabilities, you just had Cassie win a world record in
Cassie
running.
Just ran a 100-meter dash and has a Guinness record for the fastest bipedal robot to run a 100-meter dash.
And that was done with a learned policy.
Entirely learned policy. So the policy did have to make some choices. It had to start from a stand. When you say ready, set, go, the robot had to, not listening to you, press the button, but it's still from a stand, had to then accelerate up to a running speed, run past the finish line, and then slow down to a stop. Those were the rules for the Guinness world record.
So in that case, is it fair to characterize what the learned policy was optimizing within a set of decisions that had already been made? It was not, you got a Tinker Toy set and you built a robot and then it's like, learned policy, make it run.
That's right. The most important part is when you're trying to learn the policy, you don't just throw everything at it and say, hey, I just want you to get from point A to point B, thrash for a million years in simulation time and figure it out. It's unlikely to come to the solution that you want. And we already know the answer. You know, we may not be able to represent it perfectly with an engineered controller, and that's what learning is for, is how to actually have a much better, more nuanced, detailed, effective representation of this behavior that you already understand. Well, we're just thinking forward now to, like, you know, what are robots going to be like in the next 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years? And how are they going to be controlled and how are they going to be done? In the past, I would say, you know, we had model-based controllers and heuristic engineers write down the equation to describe what the answer is. And more, all of these things, I think, are going to be optimizations and learned policies where the engineers have to know what the answer looks like, but are then writing down the constraints and the bounds around that and the approaches to let the optimizers of the learning policies then get to those known and understood solutions. Also then thinking more broadly, you know, we talked about image recognition, but also Dall-E is something that you basically talk to and get out art. Obviously, we're going to need to be able to talk to robots and have them do useful things with us and for us.
And that raises a good point about sort of how we think about the API. You know, one of the things that the Dall-E conversation prompted us to talk about was, what does it even mean to have an API in the context of the robot? So the API is what you use as an outside user of the robot to tell the robot what to do.
The application programming interface.
Right. Yeah. So I want you to walk to point A, I want you to pick up a box, I want you to carry the box to point B, put down the box. Is that actually code that you're typing, or are you literally just saying that as an English language description? And the latter may be the direction actually that the API is going over a long
time. Well, look, our whole vision is enable humans to be more human, right? And the point of that is you want robots to be coming to where we are, rather than us having to, say, learn a whole programming language to make the robot do something. Eventually, you're going to want to just be able to interact with our machine, a robot, the way that you would other people, to talk to it, to get it to do useful things.
So as a thought experiment,
right?
Should we ask Dall-E to design the next version of Digit for us?
No, we already know what the next Digit should look like. Let's give a hint. We know we've got new features coming out. Let's give a hint of what the new Digit is going to look like, some of the new features.
Dall-E, take it away.